Hello, everyone. Hello. Let me just see who we've got here. We've got quite a few of you here. That's good. Hi, Mia. Hi there. Hi, everyone. I'm just seeing who we've got. Oh, we've got some great. We've all come back, which is good. Good to see you all. Really good to see you. Mia, how are you today?
Fine, fine, fine.
Good. Have you had a good day?
No.
Oh, I'm sorry you haven't had a good day. Why? Why is that?
Because school have the exam.
Oh, it's interesting. You have a lot of exams in Taiwan, don't you? Have a lot of exams. In England, we used to get a thing called a test, you know, like not a proper exam, a test maybe every month. And then we'd have a big exam, you know, like three times a year, but not like a lot, but you still seem to get a lot of exams. So that's a shame. Gina, hello, Gina. How are you today?
Hello, I'm very fine. I learned new technology today, so I'm so
Oh,
happy.
okay, you're on new technology. Oh, okay. Well, let's hope it's working well. I'm on quite old technology. My iMac, which sometimes the microphone is a bit crackly, so I apologize for that. Isabel, how are you today?
Great.
Good. Have you had a good day?
Yes.
Excellent. I'm pleased. I'm pleased. I'm pleased. Leo, welcome.
Hello.
How are you today, mate? Are you well?
I think so-so because
Oh.
tomorrow I also have the exam,
Oh,
and
you have an exam tomorrow.
yeah, we have. I think this week is all have exam, and tomorrow is the last day.
Oh, okay. Well, I wish you well. Hello, Kathy. Hello. Can you
Hello.
hear me, Kathy? Welcome
Yes.
to my class. Welcome. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Oh, thank you for coming. I think it's the first time you have been in my class. Is that correct? Your
Yes.
first time. Excellent.
Yes.
Well, welcome to my class. Thank you for coming today. We've got a big group of you. Just to quickly tell you, the other students know me, but my name is Greg, and I live in London, in North London, in an area called Camden Town, which has got a big market that many people come to visit. So it's quite exciting. Sophie's been there. Where do you live, Kathy?
I live in Taiwan in Hsinchu.
Oh, in where do you live in Hsinchu, did you say? Which town?
Hsinchu.
Oh, lovely. Okay, excellent. Well, thank you for coming today. And we've got someone else joining, Andy. We've got hundreds of people today, or actually, eight of you. Hello, Andy. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Oh, good. Can you put your screen on? Oh, I hope you can. Oh, is it working? Yeah, we've got something. Hi. Excellent. Welcome, Andy. I think you are new to my class. Is that correct?
Yes.
Excellent. Please tell me, do you live in Taiwan?
Yeah.
Excellent. Where do you live in Taipei?
Taichung.
Taichung. Okay, lovely. Excellent. And are you studying?
Yeah.
Excellent. And Kathy, are you studying?
Yes.
Excellent. Well done. And welcome to some of my more regular students. Min, hello. Hi,
Hello.
Min. How are you today, love? Are you well?
Today not good.
Oh, well, I'm sorry. Well, we must give a big hug to
Thank
Min
you.
because she's
Thank
not
you.
having a good day. Why is that, Min?
I feel
upset because
Oh.
I think I try a lot of, but my co-work still had
Yeah.
a lot of opinion on me.
Oh.
And I know I shouldn't be affected,
Yeah.
but I was still feel
Upset.
upset.
Yeah.
So
Yeah.
I decide to come here.
Good.
Maybe English class can make me happy.
Oh, I hope so. I hope so. Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. I'll just tell the other group members of the group, we were talking on Mondays. I do a lifestyle class where we talk quite honestly about emotions and things. And you're all studying mainly. And I think, well, Gina can maybe confirm with me, even when you get a bit older, the emotions that you have, you still have the strong emotions and feelings. You maybe can work through them a bit better, but it is complicated, especially at work. You know, you have to find a way at work, like at school in a way, of dealing with people's emotions and feelings and your own. There's no straightforward way, I would say. I mean, but maybe on Monday, come on Monday if you can, because we have an interesting class where we talk about emotions and things. Sophie, my dear, how are you today?
I'm good. I spend most of my time with my plants, so I'm really happy.
Good. Well,
yeah,
that
being there.
I must say to everyone, spending time in nature or with plants is very good for your mental health. It really can help. It may seem a bit crazy what I'm saying. You think, for those of you who don't involve yourself with green things growing, but in fact, it's very, very good for your mental health. And I really recommend you sort of working and at least having 5 minutes a day where you try and get some green in your life, growing things in your life, because it's very good for you. I think so. Anyway, we're going to start the class. And the last couple of weeks, I've been doing the mystery object at the beginning of the class for some of you who know this, because as you can see, I have a lot of things behind me. I collect old things. I don't know if you can see, I collect ceramics. Just to grab something, look, I collect ceramics, very old, interesting ceramics. But I collect other things as well, which I've used in my work. And I suddenly thought it would be fun to start showing you an object at the beginning of the class. And then at the end, you can have a think, we can guess, I will tell you what it is. So today's object, well, there's two things. You might know what this object is, but this has a specific use. So I'm going to show you the object. But look, it's a bit strange. Now, does anyone know what the word for this thing is? Do you know what this thing is? Do you know what it is? It actually goes that way when it's used. But this is just this is not a real one. This is like, because the real ones in life are bigger. But does anyone know, Mia, any ideas what this object is?
It's a horse fish. Feet.
Yes, you are a horseshoe. Yes, done. That's really good. That's excellent. Let me just put that in the thing. Horseshoe. Can everyone see my screen?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Let me just put that. Let me just get post attendee out of the way. It's called. Oh, I've got French for some reason. Horseshoe. A horse shoe, basically, that's what it is, a shoe for horses. So let me stop sharing and come back. Now, I'll quickly tell you, does anyone know how you get a horse shoe on the horse? Someone's got a very loud microphone or something playing in the background, I can hear. Someone got a television playing? I can hear someone's voice very loudly in the background, by the way. No? Okay, we might work that out, whose that is. Okay, if you can turn that down, it would be helpful. So a horseshoe, how does it go on the horse's feet? Leo, do you know? How do you get a horseshoe to stay on a horse's foot? Well, because it won't just look, it's just going to fall off. You know, it goes, this is the shoe, this is the foot of the horse, this is the shoe, horseshoe, metal horseshoe. How do they get it to stay on the horse, on the horse's foot? Do you know?
I think they will use fire to make it very hot.
Fire?
And, yeah.
Okay.
Then
anything else?
Put on the bottom of the shoe's leg, and it will be like
what, like glued on by the fire, you mean?
Yeah.
Okay, that would be a bit horrible for the horse, wouldn't it? That would be a bit like, let's burn your feet and hope that the horseshoe stays on. That would be horrible, horrible thing to do.
But the feet of the horse is
hard,
like the very thick nail, right?
True, that is true, that is true. But they do use something else. Gina, do you know?
In the snow?
What, sorry? What?
The horse can stab in the snow.
Stabbing, did you say?
In the snow.
In the snow. No, I don't think so. You're a bit, the line is a bit crackly because I can hear someone in the back. Kathy, do you know how do they get the horseshoe to stay on the foot of the horse?
I don't know.
There is a slight clue. Can you see these little marks here?
Yes.
So, do you know what they do?
I can't see very.
Oh, okay.
Clear.
Well, this is only a pretend horseshoe, so I'll explain. I'll explain a bit. Andy, do you know?
I don't have any idea. I don't have any idea.
Okay, no worries. Isabel, do you know?
No.
Nope. Okay. And we've got Min and Sophie. I think Sophie knows. Min, I think.
I know.
I think Sophie does know. Min, do you know how they? We'll just ask me first because I think Sophie's got it.
I don't know. Maybe this thing is have some shape, so maybe can match the horse.
Okay, yeah, you're right. The shape is similar. Yeah. Like a thing that would fit. Sophie, what's the answer?
So basically, I really want to say that because I had to mind. I used to work in a race court, and so basically the horseshoes, they were made for the every horses because they had to, apparently they have different feet, and
yes.
So they were heat up to a certain level so the metal was easily to be bent, and
yeah.
for the horses, and then they were quartered down and use a nail
right.
And hammered for
that's
for
right.
The horse
are little holes. These are holes in the big horse. This is only a pretend horseshoe. These are holes. And so what they do is they get the horse's foot up like that, they put the thing on, and then they hammer nails in through the holes into the foot of the horse. It does not hurt the foot, does not hurt the horse. As Leo said, and I was slightly joking with you, Leo.
Yeah.
But it's true. They're very hard, like Leo said. It's very hard. So they can bang special nails, and they're sort of funny shaped square nails at the bottom to go into the horse, and that's what keeps the horse's horse's shoes in. Also just because in England we have lots of traditions connected to horses, as many countries do. But if you store a horseshoe, you're supposed to, on the wall, people have them in, or you're supposed to, they're lucky, supposedly. So you mustn't store them that way because all the luck comes out. You're supposed to store them this way and all the luck stays in. But that's just a story. But this object is a horseshoe, but it has a reason. It does something. Can you see there's like a little thing there? Can you all see that little hook? And obviously a hook here. And I don't know if I can show you. This does stand up. Oops, not very well. It does stand up. And this is for one particular thing. One reason why, what this does. And it's something, it's connected to the end of the day. Connected to the end of the day, and something goes on here on this hook. So, and it's made of copper. This is made of copper, the mineral, metal, copper. I'll just put that in the share and just have a look. So it's a copper horseshoe. A copper, can you all see that? Copper, made of copper, so it's a copper horseshoe. Right, I'm going to stop sharing. So have a think what you think might be the actual thing that we, that it could be. Any ideas? Just as a shout out quickly, Andy, any ideas?
You say this thing will maybe help. Help horse maybe run fast.
Okay, well this is just decorative, so it's actually something to do with humans, this, because it's too small for a horse. They've done it as a horseshoe because it's lucky, but this isn't for a horse. This is something humans use. This is something that a human being would use, and it's very nice because this moves as well, so something human beings would use. Kathy, any ideas?
No, I have no idea.
Okay, no worries. Gina, any idea? No. Okay, Leo, any idea?
Because people use it to at night, at the end of a day.
Yeah, something to do at the end of the day. But remember, is old. So I should give you a clue. This isn't from now. This is about 100 years old, 120 years old, this object. Something 120. Well, have a think. You're going in the right direction. Isabel, any ideas?
No.
Okay. Min, any ideas?
I guess when people come home and they can put the key.
That is a good idea. Actually, it would work now for keys. That's a really good idea. You think that's a great idea, so you don't lose your keys. You hang the key on the hook. That's actually an excellent idea for now. Yeah, I mean, if I should do that myself, I think. Yeah, I should do that myself. Mia, any ideas?
No.
Okay. Sophie, any ideas at the moment? Keys is good.
About the candle. Insert the candle there.
Yeah.
It's difficult to put a candle in there. Drip. You need to have it this way up as well. There's a reason why it has to stand this way up as well. Well, I'll give you another clue a bit later on. I'm just trying to see. I've got the cue. I've got a bit of another cue. I was just looking for it. Another bit of a cue later on, which I won't show you yet. But we're going to do, for the new people who've joined today, I like to do a word quiz as well. And the word quiz we do is Wordle. I don't know if you've heard of Wordle, Kathy or Andy. It's quite fun. It's very easy. It's an American. Well, it was English originally, but now it's published in the American newspapers. And I'll show you. It's basically what we have to do is we have to find a five-letter word, a five-letter word. You'll understand how it works because basically, if you get the right letter in the right place, it goes green. If you get the right letter in the wrong place, it goes yellow. If you get the wrong letter, it goes gray. So I'll let you, the new people can start, fairly new people start. Kathy, can you think of a five-letter English word? Any word you like.
Happy.
What was that? What did you say? Typey.
Happy.
Oh, happy. Sorry, I didn't hear your first one. Happy. Excellent. Happy. Okay, cool. Thank you. Let's have a look. And you'll see how it start works now once I click. Oh, well done. Well done. You've got a letter, which is really good. You've got a letter. So that's a good start. You found an A. It's not in the right place, but we need to find some more letters. So that's good. Andy, you go next. We need a five-letter word with an A in it. So five letters with an A in it. Can you give me a five-letter English word with an A?
Apple.
Apple. Apple's good, except we have used the P's already.
Okay.
Yes, another thing. P's aren't right, H isn't right. You've got all the other, you've got S, T, M, B.
Alert.
Alert's good. That's a really good one. Really good one. I'm sorry. Alert, great choice. Great, good thinking, because we've used a lot of letters there, different letters. Okay, let's have a look. Amazing. Well done. Can you see, everyone? We've got, Andy's done well. He's got found the last letter and he's got another letter and another letter. So we know it ends in T. We've got to find two more letters and we've got to put these in different places to make a word, right? To make a word. Does that make sense, everyone? Gina, you go next. Can you think of a word with a couple I can think of actually, R-A-R-T, and there's loads actually. If you think from the beginning, I'm giving you a clue, there's a word there. Another word for the beginning. Well, choose any word you like. Any idea? You're on silent. Okay, no worries. Don't worry, I'll go up to Leo. Leo, give me your
Admit.
Admit, that's a good word. We'll choose that. We're not using the R, but it might help us. Let's have a look. Admit, even though the A is wrong. But that's a good thinking, though. Good brain work there.
No.
The A has got to move. I think we need to put the A and the R somewhere in the middle. So start with another letter. Do you know what I mean? Like instead of the, you know, something R. You know, there's lots of words like bruh and cruh and fra and even ra. Do you see what I mean? Or even another word with a T in front, so tra. So we've got to find a letter, and then I think the A will go somewhere in the middle, if that makes sense. Does that make sense? Okay, Isabel.
Start.
Start. Yeah, that's what I was saying at the beginning. Well done. You got my thinking there. Start. Let's have a look at this. Start. Good thinking. Because we okay, the R's in the same place, but we've got the A in a different place and we've got some other letters. So let's have a look. Well done. Excellent. 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 We found the A. That's the crucial letter to. So now, also, this is a bit like doing maths. It may seem crazy. You've got to look where the other letters have been. We know R can't go there. Right. We know A goes there and T goes there. So R's got to go either there or there. Now, I can, funny enough, I can think of a word that begins with R that's got an A and a T at the end. But I've got the feeling the R needs to go there. So who have we got? Have we lost someone? No, I think we've got everyone here still. Mia, any ideas?
No.
No? Okay, no worries. It's a tricky one, but it's actually sort of quite an obvious word as well today. It's quite a good word to choose. We'll go on to Min. Min is a bit of a star at this game, I have to tell you. She is... got so many, and also Sophie as well. So that's why I'm not being horrible to them. I've left until last because the other day Sophie got it in two. So that was just like, in fact, she was got it so quick, no one had any other goes, you know. Great, but great for Sophie, not great for everyone else. Min is also very good. So Min, any ideas? We've got to get it in these last two, by the way.
Roast.
Roast, did you say?
Yes.
Yeah, roast. But the problem is with roast, and I think we have to be careful because we don't want to waste our turns. S is wrong. S is wrong. There's no S in it. I think the R has got to go second. We need a letter. We need the R second. And then something, something. And then a letter in front of the R. So look down like cruh. As I said, bruh. Words beginning with BR. Words beginning with CR. Words beginning with FR. And there's even some words beginning with WR, which is a bit harder. And words even beginning with GR.
GR.
So let me just go back to Gina because she couldn't think of anything a minute ago. Gina, any ideas now? Oh, you're on silent, Gina. You're on mute. You're on mute.
The end is
H. The end is T, yeah. And so can you think of a letter that would go between the T and the A?
I don't know any word where the end is ang.
Ang. Well, yeah, there's quite a few words, but we've got the T on the end. So we need a letter to go between the A and the T. Let me just go back and see before we go. Oh, I'll go back to Mia. Mia. Can you think of any letter? What letter would you choose between to go between the A and the T that we haven't used? There's one very obvious one. Lots of words have it in. What's so like as a common sound, in fact, a common sound in words? No, don't worry. Let me just go down and see if there's anyone else we've missed. Kathy, do you want to have another go?
G-R-A-N-T.
G-R-A-N-T. So you're saying grant. Okay. Grant. Is that what you mean? Grant. Okay. Let's have a look. That's a good thinking. Good thinking if you got it. Well done. Congratulations. Well done. That's amazing. Amazingly good thinking, Kathy. Congratulations. That's your first one and you're new as well. Well done. I mean, there were other words, you know, we could have chosen like, well, in that thing, we could have actually had, but in the before we put that in, we could have had the word giant as well, except we'd use the I. And craft as well, we hadn't tried. Craft, C-R-A-F-T, craft is a good choice, but it is grant. So well done. Good thinking. Good thinking. Excellent. I'm really happy. Well done. Let me just check. I've just got one message. Let me just check what that says. Grant, thank you for putting it in. Excellent. Let me just stop sharing for a minute. Well, actually, no, we'll go on. Let me just go on to get rid of this. And we'll go on to the subject today, which is Goths or Gothic, really Gothic, without C. That's rather. Now, when I write the word Gothic, have a think for a moment. Any word that comes into your head when I say the word Gothic, any feeling or thought, doesn't matter if it's wrong or right, anything. Sophie, hit me with your best shot. Gothic. What do you think?
I will relate it to dark magic.
Magic, did you say? Magic.
Dark magic. Yeah,
dark magic.
Basically dark. Yeah, dark very magic. Dark.
Very dark magic. Very dark magic. Very dark magic. Cool. Gina. What do you think when we think of the word Gothic? What does it make you?
Gorgeous.
Dangerous. Dangerous. Why dangerous?
Not correct.
Not correct. Not good, you mean?
Underground.
Very underground. Okay, very underground. Oh, interesting. Underground, you mean? Okay, interesting. Okay, Leo, what do you think when you hear the word Gothic?
Gothic. I don't know.
Anything? Do you know the word? Have you seen the word before?
Maybe architect.
Architecture. So good. I was hoping someone would say that. Yeah, I was hoping so. Oh, it's not it, right? I was hoping someone would say that, architecture, because literally Gothic in England, before the style of everything, Gothic was a style of architecture on churches. Our big buildings. Gothic was a style of very elaborate architecture, and I'll quickly show you Gothic architecture. If I can get the video up, get a page up. Like this, basically. Can you see? These are churches which are very, very Gothic in architecture style. They're very beautiful. If you come to England, amazing, because they're incredibly old and they're so beautiful inside. I think this is an AI generated image, to be honest, but many do look like that. Sophie, you visited a few churches in England, I think.
I do, and also some churches in Europe. I went to Lyon, and that's one. Yeah, and that's one of the churches which is built with Gothic style. I've forgotten the name of it.
Paris.
It's really Lyon.
Oh, in Lyon, yes. Lyon. It's a famous cathedral in Lyon. Gothic.
And I think it can trace back, and it's Gothic style, that I think.
Well, it's a Gothic.
I've forgotten the name.
It is,
and also the very prestigious one.
Yes.
Like, a lot of people know it, but I have no idea how to pronounce it.
But
it's really beautiful inside. And I think it's like, I'm not quite sure whether the pilot, because some of the people say when you look on the ceiling, it actually had a very special style of Gothic, that it actually will have like something cross or something.
Okay. Well, there's many Gothic architecture, just to tell you. There's Gothic Revival, Neo-Gothic, you know, there's all these different things. Okay, well done, Leo. Excellent. Kathy, what do you think when you think of the word Gothic? What do you think?
I don't know. I haven't seen.
You don't know the word. Okay, interesting. Well, no worries. Andy, what do you think when you think of the word Gothic?
A god.
Well, sorry, what was that? I didn't hear you.
A god.
The god, did you say? The god. I didn't quite hear that. Sorry, you might have to write god. That in the...
G-O-D.
Oh, god. Oh, G-O-D.
Yeah.
God. Oh, okay, Gothic god. Okay, interesting. Well, we're going to watch the video, but basically there's a whole, I don't know, Gothic and how it, Goths are a style of dress and a style of person, really. You know, a bit like in England, we have people who follow different music scenes, and Goths are people who like a certain style. It's a style of dress. It's quite interesting. I have to say, I recommend, well, I don't know if I recommend it, but it's an interesting thing. Mia, what do you think about the word Gothic?
It's very mysterious.
Serious? Oh, yeah, you're right. Actually, that is a good, that is a very good word to use, because the people who are Goths, who dress, I used to know someone who dressed as a Goth. And they were very serious about it. They were very, you know, it had to be all right. You know, the makeup, the costume had to be very, you couldn't be a Goth on Wednesday and then be something else on Tuesday. You had to be a Goth every day. So yeah, serious is very, very good, I think. Very, very good. Isabel, what do you think?
Special.
Yeah, it's quite a special look, like, if you like. It's a special look, maybe, a special look. Gina, did I come to you? I can't remember. Gina, what do you think?
Yes, I also think glam.
Oh, what? Sorry, I didn't quite hear the word.
Glam.
Grim. Oh, yes, we talked about that. We talked about grim. Did you say grim? Grim, yeah? Is that what you were saying?
G-R-A-N.
G-R-A-N. Grand.
Grand.
Grander. Grand. Do you mean grand? Because grand's not a... That's not a word. Grand isn't a word. Do you mean grand?
Gorgeous.
Sorry, what did you say?
Gorgeous.
Gorgeous. Oh, okay. Sorry, I thought you said G-R. Gorgeous. Okay, that's quite an interesting idea of that. Gorgeous. Well, it's quite, yeah, maybe it's gorgeous. I'm not sure about that personally, but let's see. And Min, what do you think about Goths?
I think of their clothes.
Their clothes, yeah. It's very distinctive. Clothes, yeah. I think absolutely right. That's very true. Now, and also, there's something which is sort of Sophie mentioned very dark magic. I'm just going to show you a thing. This is not exactly a goth thing because it's older. It's an object I'm going to show you. But it's something that goths like, the idea of it, which is, can you see my, or I have to, sorry, I have to go because I can't see what I'm showing you. Can you all see that? Now, this is a very goth thing. Very, very goth thing. Can you see? You can see what it is. Do you know what this is, everyone? Andy, do you know what this is?
Maybe instrument.
Oh, okay. No, you don't all know what it is. Interesting. Okay. let me just, Gina, you know what this is. What is this, Gina? Do you not know? What do you think it is, Gina?
Smoke.
A what, sorry?
Smoke,
yeah, a pipe. Yes, it's a pipe. Yeah, absolutely. It's a pipe. Because there's a lot of you, I have to just check. I can see what I'm doing with my eyes. Yeah, look. You put this in your mouth. You'd light the tobacco in there and smoke would come out. And the reason it's a skull, it's known as a concept in England, which we have, and other cultures do, from a long time ago. It's called memento mori. It's Latin. And it sounds crazy, but a long time ago, people liked to think about death because they had to remember that in life is death, if you like. But, you know, we were very close to the grave. You know, you could get ill quick and die. So people often celebrated life by having symbols of skulls and things like that. This is a memento mori type. It's about 100 years old. It's very different. Made of wood, in fact, made of one piece of wood, which is beautiful. Goths like that. So we're going to watch the video. I'm aware of time, but I also want to play you a song. This is, hopefully, I've got some translation up. Can you all see my screen, yeah? Everyone? Yeah? See my screen? See the video? Okay, let's watch the video. I don't know if we're watching how good it is, but we can maybe go... stop because I want to play you some songs as well and today, but let's have a look. Okay.
What do fans of atmospheric post-punk music have in common with ancient barbarians? Not much. So why are both known as goths? Is it a weird coincidence or a deeper connection stretching across the centuries? The story begins in ancient Rome. As the Roman Empire expanded, it faced raids and invasions from the semi-nomadic populations along its borders. Among the most powerful were a Germanic people known as Goths, who were composed of two tribal groups, the Visigoths and Ostrogoths. While some of the Germanic tribes remained Rome's enemies, the empire incorporated others into the imperial army. As the Roman Empire split in two, these tribal armies played larger roles in its defense and internal power struggles. In the 5th century, a mercenary revolt led by a soldier named Odoacer captured Rome and deposed the Western Emperor. Odoacer and his Ostrogoth successor, Theodoric, technically remained under the Eastern Emperor's authority and maintained Roman traditions. But the Western Empire would never be united again. Its dominions fragmented into kingdoms ruled by Goths and other Germanic tribes, assimilated into local cultures, though many of their names still mark the map. This was the end of the classical period and the beginning of what many call the Dark Ages. Although Roman culture was never fully lost, its influence declined. New art styles rose, focused on religious symbolism and allegory rather than proportion and realism. This shift extended to architecture with the construction of the Abbey of Saint-Denis in France in 1137. pointed arches, flying buttresses, and large windows made the structure more skeletal and ornate. That emphasized its open, luminous interior rather than the sturdy walls and columns of classical buildings. Over the next few centuries, this became a model for cathedrals throughout Europe. But fashions change. With the Italian Renaissance's renewed admiration for ancient Greece and Rome, the more recent style began to seem crude and inferior in comparison. Writing in his 1550 book, Lives of the Artists, Giorgio Vasari was the first to describe it as Gothic, a derogatory reference to the barbarians thought to have destroyed classical civilization. The name stuck and soon came to describe the medieval period overall, with its associations of darkness, superstition, and simplicity. But time marched on, as did what was considered fashionable. In the 1700s, a period called the Enlightenment came about, with scientific reason above all else. Reacting against that, romantic authors like Goethe and Byron sought idealized visions of a past of landscapes and mysterious spiritual forces. The word Gothic was repurposed again to describe a literary genre that emerged as a darker strain of romanticism. The term was first applied by Horace Walpole to his own 1764 novel, Otranto, as a reference to the plot and general atmosphere. Many of the novel's elements became movies. The label belonged to literature and film until the 1970s, when a new musical scene emerged. Taking cues from artists like The Doors and The Velvet Underground, British post-punk groups like Joy Division, Bauhaus, and The Cure combined gloomy lyrics and punk dissonance with imagery inspired by the Victorian era, classic horror, and androgynous glam fashion. By the early 1980s, similar bands were consistently described as Gothic rock by the music press, and the style's popularity brought it out of dimly lit clubs to major labels and MTV. And today, despite occasional negative media attention and stereotypes, Gothic music and fashion continue as a strong underground phenomenon. They've also branched into subgenres such as cybergoth, gothabilly, gothic metal, and even steampunk. The history of the word Gothic is embedded in thousands of years worth of countercultural movements. From invading outsiders becoming kings, to towering spires replacing solid columns, to artists finding beauty in darkness. Each step has seen a revolution of sorts and a tendency for civilization to reach into its past to reshape its present.
That was actually a very good video, I have to say. I think, did the translation work? Well, was it okay, the translation for everyone? Is it quite good, the Taiwanese so you could understand? Does that make sense? Okay, well, before we go on, I want you to ask two questions. Can you think of a Gothic novel, the most famous, there was two really, the most famous Gothic novels, which still are very well known today? There's one, the most famous one, and there's another one as well. Because there's something that, well, we sort of slightly talked about it, but no one mentioned the character. It's two different characters and two different novels. So we'll start with the people. Kathy, can you think of a Gothic novel, the two most famous Gothic novels? Or one, give me one if you can think of it. They're very well known throughout the whole world. They become films and television shows. It's all about darkness and supernatural. Nope, don't worry. We'll go on to Leo. Leo, can you give me one? A Gothic novel, a dark Gothic novel.
I just guess The Lord of the Rings.
Lord of the Rings. Yeah, do you know, that's, I'll take Lord of the Rings. That wasn't what I was thinking, but I agree. It is a quite a gothic novel, actually. It's quite a gothic novel. It's a good choice. Very good choice. Andy, can you give me one? Very famous. It's one, both two different novels. Both have one word names. One word names for the novel. Any idea? Frost. I don't know of a novel called, but I'll believe you. I'll take the words. Good word. Great name for a novel. It's not necessarily the novel I was thinking. Gina, can you think of a novel?
Frankenstein.
Yes, yeah, brilliant. Well done. Frankenstein. Yeah. Has everyone heard of Frankenstein? Mm-hmm. Frankenstein, or the modern Prometheus. And does anyone know who wrote Frankenstein? It was a lady, a fabulous, brilliant woman writer, whose husband was a brilliant poet, but she was just as good as him. Her name was Mary Shelley. And the story of Frankenstein and how she came to write it is very interesting. Very interesting. Mary Shelley. Interestingly, not that you might not know this, the name of the monster in Frankenstein isn't Frankenstein. The name of the monster in Frankenstein is the monster. The doctor who creates Frankenstein, who creates the monster, is called Frankenstein, Dr. Frankenstein. So lots of people think the monster's called Frankenstein, but he's not. It's called the monster. Okay, one more, another novel. Mia, can you give me another? The most famous, the one thing, if you look back at, with very dark magic, dangerous, underground, gods.
Wuthering Heights.
That is a great choice. That is a great choice. Wuthering Heights. Yeah, it's a very gothic novel. Written by Emily Bronte. It has a very dark, brooding hero, a very gothic hero. But there's a scary supernatural novel I'm looking for. Isabel, can you think? It's one word. It's a man. Well, it's not a man. It's a something not quite a man. Something that was a man that's no longer a man, but is still alive. Can you think of something? As a word, no one's told me yet here. I was expecting to see. It's the name of a man, a scary figure. Can you think of the name?
No.
No? Okay. Lynn, give me the name. I'll give you a clue. Hang on. I'm sitting here. And then like, I'm sitting here like that. I'll be the other person. That's that's the clue. Min?
I won't say the Adams family. But
Adams family. Yeah, that's great. But the Adams family is more modern. Yeah, the classic novel I'm looking. I agree, Adams family. I think I spelled that wrong. Adam's family. Yeah, can anyone let me just see. Gina, can you give me you gave me Frankenstein, so we'll go back to Kathy. Can you give me the name? Nope. Okay.
Can I say that? Sorry.
Yeah, go on. No, tell me. What is it, Sylvia?
It's so Dracula.
Yes, Dracula. Dracula, you all know Dracula. Dracula. You know Dracula?
Yes.
Does everyone know Dracula? He's a vampire. And the story of Dracula, there are some very early versions of, but the main story of Dracula was written by a man who was an English, well, he worked in England. He was called Bram Stoker. Bram Stoker, and he worked in a theatre, and it was written in the 19th century. And the original story is a very good story. He's an interesting man, Bram Stoker. Dracula is a very gothic novel, very, very gothic, very interesting novel. Yeah, I mean, there's some amazing adaptations, television adaptations. I don't know. Have you all? I'll just see if I can find it, actually. I'm just looking at what we've got here. Just see if I can find the trailer. I'm just looking. This is the one, I think. I think it's this one. It's the most recent series of Dracula. The most recent series of Dracula. This was on the BBC, and you might be able to watch it. It was very good. The guy who played Dracula was brilliant because he was dark, but he was also he was sort of attractive. And also, he didn't just bite women, he bit men as well. So he turned lots of different people into vampires the whole time. So I don't know if you might be a bit frightened by this, but I'm sure he's not outside your window tonight, hopefully in Taiwan. I check before you go to bed, but just to be sure, but you never know. Boys and girls, do check. But this is the trailer. It was very good. I think you'll get an idea of the show.
He's a very persuasive man, the cat. He's a monster. And my woman said, sit up with him.
This is devilry.
It's worse than death.
It is the devil.
You have no idea. I'm going to destroy everything and everyone you need.
I've studied the legends. I know who you are.
I'm undead. I'm not unreasonable.
It's very good, I have to say. It's very scary. It's also quite funny in places, but it's very scary. I'm going to play you a song. I've just suddenly thought of a song, the one I was going to play you, but I'm going to play you another one. Because this is actually a very gothic looking song, if I can quickly find it. This is some of you have seen this before. It's actually very interesting English, strange video. It was their one big hit, and it's very, very gothic. There's also a very funny version, which I think I've played, which I love. But this is the video. It's by a band called Shakespeare's Sister from quite a few years ago. And it's really strange song. It's a very good song. I've got a little trailer first. Ignore the advert, but I can't get rid of it. This is a band called Shakespeare's Sister, and you might enjoy this. It's a very good video, I think. Did you understand? Just to ask you, I'll stop sharing. Oh, actually, I'll want to show you the other funny bit of a funny version. Who was the other lady? Do you know? Could you guess who the other lady was supposed to be? Kathy, who do you think the other lady was? She was a figure. She was obviously. Any ideas? You're on mute, by the way. It's very gothic. Andy, who do you think she was? The other sparkly lady, the slightly mad lady.
I don't have no idea. I just heard her. She's singing. Yeah.
She's singing what? Sorry.
She's singing.
Yeah, she's singing. She's singing, but she was portraying someone. Who do you think she was, Gina?
Herself.
Yeah, she could be her soul. Yeah, I can take that. That's a good idea. Isabel, who do you think she was?
A devil.
A devil, yeah. I can accept a devil. Yeah, she could be a devil. Leo, who do you think she was?
A lover.
A lover. Interesting. Okay. Well, I think, I'm not sure exactly, but I think she represents death. Do you understand? He's in a hospital and he's in a machine that's keeping him breathing. And what she's saying that when he's in a coma, obviously death is saying to him, come to me. Death is coming. You know, she's the female version of death. So his lover has to fight death to keep him alive. And she wins. And that's the idea. I'll just quickly show you, because I don't know if I can show you this, but this is a funny version of this song that was done by someone. And this is a parody of this song. And this is very funny. This is English, English humor. I don't know if you'll get this.
Sorry, not this. This is a video. Worth dying to thee, particularly, and to all the Volskys. Great hurt.
This is a parody of the video.
If the sword is wearing thin, and you think it will escape, I'll go anywhere with you. Just wrap me up in chains. But if you try to go alone, don't think I'll understand.
It's very funny.
Thank you.
I'm showing you that in a way because two words, I'm just going to put them in the translation. Parody and spoof, I think, are very much part of gothicness and camp as well. The word camp, which you'll have, I'll try and explain another day because that video is camp. It's about joking about something that's serious. Does that make sense to everyone? Joking when something is very serious, it becomes funny. And it's something that's distinctly English humor, joking about things which are funny. And gothicness and goths, there is an element of spoof and camp, as in with the Dracula. Dracula is quite jokey in a weird way. It's horrible, but he's also jokey. He says, I don't know if you saw in the clip, he says, I may be undead, but I'm not unreasonable, you know, which is a very clever line. Anyway, I'm going to stop sharing because I'm aware of the time. So back to the object. Now I'm going to show you something else. Well, I've got part of it in my hand. This is a clue. So any ideas what this object is? Any more? Mia, give me a word, one word. What is it? Or two words? There's a bit of a... I'm holding the crucial thing in my hand. I'm not going to show you yet, but...
just put the... meat.
No, Sophie.
Key. Can you put key?
Key? No, we've done the key. Leo.
I have no idea.
Okay. Who have we got next? Where's my key on? Isabel.
Oh, I don't know.
Oh, Min?
Can hang necklace?
You can hang what on it, did you say?
Necklace.
A necklace.
Necklace.
I didn't hear the word, sorry, it's just my screen. Necklace, good idea. Sort of wrong, but good idea. Gina. Nope. Okay. Andy. Any idea?
No.
No, okay, and Kathy, last go.
Oh.
No, okay. Well, this is a clue, a bit more of a clue. This is a chain, as you can see. It's made of solid silver, and a gentleman, 100 years ago, would have worn this on his waistcoat, just to show you where, sort of about there on his waistcoat. Now, what am I holding in my hand? It went in his pocket. What do you think I'm holding in my hand? Any ideas? A clock. Well, you're sort of right. It's a watch. Now, I don't know if you realize, but wristwatches are quite a recent invention. They're only over about 120 years old. Wristwatches didn't exist. People had these. They were called pocket watches. Pocket watches. And this one, which I have, which is very nice, you wind it. But I haven't got the key with me, I think. But you wind it in the back. There's a little key and you wind it. It's not electric, it's before electric. But the important thing, oh yeah, the key is there, just to show you, a little key. Can you see the little key? And then it goes in the back, just to show you. And you wind it. And you might be able to hear it ticking. I don't know, but it's now working. Can you see the hand moving? The second hand moving.
Yeah,
so in the evening when you took your waistcoat off and you needed somewhere to put your watch so it would keep going, you'd hang it on your watch stand. And this is a watch stand. And you get all different ones. You get wooden ones, you get really fancy ones, but almost everyone would have had a pocket watch. Even the most basic person, even a cheap one, not made of silver. Because obviously you needed to get up and go to work and check what time you finished. So many people had a watch and they would have a watch stand that would hang you would hang your watch from in the evening. I don't know if I can put it on something to show you a bit better. Yeah. So it would hang like that. So this is a little watch stand. And this is a watch actually that I've had for many years. And sometimes when I go out to interesting places in London for an evening, I sometimes wear this watch in a waistcoat in a classical way. And this is the thing that holds it into the waistcoat, which is very nice. So it goes like that, and it goes, this hangs in a pocket, and so does this little thing to protect the key. So I hope you found that interesting, a bit of social history. Guys, thank you so much for coming today. Really great class, and so lovely to have such a big class with all of you as well. Really lovely. I hope Kathy and Andy found it interesting. Thank you for coming. Don't worry too much about the vampires outside your window tonight with Dracula. Hopefully he won't come and get you. And I'll see you all next week, hopefully. So thank you so much, Gina. Thank you so much. Lovely to see you again. Really good to see you again. Isabel, thank you so much for coming today. Lovely to see you again. Leo, good to see you, mate. Thank you for coming.
I'm Mia,
excellent. Thank you for coming, for your contributions. Sophie, as always, a pleasure to see you.
Thank you, Greg.
I hope the herbs keep growing. Min, I wish you well for the next few days. I hope it gets better at your work. And it's only a very small part of your life, your work with those people. So focus on all the lovely bits. That's what you have to do sometimes. And Andy, I hope you come back again another day, and I wish you well. And Kathy as well, thank you very much for coming. Okay, everyone, we've gone on a bit longer, but bye for now. See you next week, hopefully.
Bye for now, Greg.
Bye. Bye. Take care. Bye.
You do.